In this video, I'm going to show how to remove the factory radio. This happens to be a 98 Dodge. It's all pretty much the same. And replace it with a second one. A couple of problems. Obviously, the factory radio is large, and most of your replacement radios are a little smaller. But that's an easy enough fix. So, I also like to do things without tearing up the dash. Well, I got some tricks to show you as far as that goes. Now, I've already pulled this dash, and it's a press-in dash, which is on occasion scary because you're always worried about breaking it. But if you go careful, it'll pop out. One thing you want to remember is right in here, there is a screw, and this is your power, auxiliary power outlet door. If you forget that, you'll break the whole corner of the dash. Work your hands underneath, scoot it along, press and pry and pop. There aren't a whole lot of other things to disconnect. There's a plug back behind your power outlet. And on this one, these are my auxiliary lights. So these are the switches that control both low and high beam lights. And then I've got a sliding window switch over there. So other than that, this is a fairly benign and easy dash to work on. When it comes to replacing the big radio with the smaller radio, mine just has this little slip-in bracket bucket thing. Of course, the problem, here's my dash, is, is that it's much smaller than the hole I want to fit into. But that's not a particularly insurmountable task. Now for my replacement backer, I'm going to use this. This is just a scrap piece. I'd avoid wood, personally. A sheet of 1/4-inch plywood would probably work every bit as well. Picked up in sheets at a home store. It doesn't matter to me because I'm going to paint it. So the fact that it's opaque and scratched is more or less meaningless to me. Go ahead and use store-bought material, which will come with cover on both sides. And then you just got to be careful not to scratch that until you're done. So what I want to make sure is I cut my piece long enough. 9 3/4, 4 3/4. You could cut this carefully and slowly with a handsaw, especially if it was wood. Simple as that. Once you got your oversized piece blocked out, you just have to hold it up, mark the various nips and tucks and cuts and things that you need to make in order to get it all to fit. Here it all is, marked up. It's a little too long, so I'm going to cut 1/4 inch off the one end. I've got it blocked out for a couple of the dash holes that it needs to go through, and it should slip right underneath the passenger side airbag trim just fine. I'm going to go cut these now, and we'll see how I did. With a piece secured with a few clamps, I'm just going to go ahead and cut it with my old jigsaw. The only thing it's important to remember when you're cutting the plastic, best to have one that will run a little slower if you don't want it to melt. And cutting it is just like cutting wood. You just don't want it to languish in the cuts too long, otherwise it'll start to melt the plastic and leave a bad cut. Not that even that would matter, because it's all hidden. And there it is, all cut. Actually goes in like that. Just head back to the truck and see how it fits. A little last minute trimming. I need to nip a little bit off right there, and then I need to mark for the bolt holes that will hold it in place. And I'm just going to reuse the same bolt holes that were used to hold the old radio in. Running hole is drilled, it's all installed. The next step will be to put the dash back on. So the trim ring's back on. Before I go ahead and mark the hole, you'll notice that we've got this gap that runs around the outside edge. You could do everything and simply fill that, maybe with some foam, maybe with additional sheets of material. I don't like the look of the gap, and I'm not overly thrilled with how it's recessed back in. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to bring the whole plate out first to match the backside lip. Once I've got that in position, then I'm going to mark in order to cut the hole for the radio itself. So what I'm going to do to solve that crack problem, I just cut some shims out, and this is just leftover scraps of what I'm using. What I'm using just happens to be 1/4 inch. So if you use all 1/4 inch material, you know that one sheet plus 3 shim packs will get you nice and flush. So I'll get a nice edge around there. And it works on both sides, so everything is good. So what I'm going to do is, this is just a test, obviously. I'm going to glue these to the back side of this. There is an appropriate plexiglass glue. I'm not going to use it. I'm just going to use 5-minute epoxy. If you'd prefer, you can get the plexiglass glue, acrylic glue essentially, and you just sort of wick it in on the joints, press them really tight, and you can fuse them together. I've used it before. It does work very well. Here, just using simple 5-minute epoxy, I've glued my strips together, got them clamped, maybe a touch overkill, certainly nice and firm. I'll set that aside and let it harden up for 10-15 minutes, even though it says 5-minute epoxy. It's better to do smaller batches than to try to push your epoxy. You don't need as much as you think, but the last thing you want to do is starve the joint. What is super essential before you put these together, however, is to take your sander, either hand sand or a mechanical, and you need to sand the blocks, both sides, until they're opaque. And that gives the epoxy a little bit of tooth to stick to, and it'll give you a much stronger joint. So this would be a finished spacer block. It's all epoxy together. And you can see where I've already got the other one, epoxy to the backside of our plate. Here's the final thing. Well, I mean, it's not 100% done, but you can see where I've added the clamps, and I had to, I know it's ugly, pop that little hole, which is that one. There's no need to carry it all the way through, so I only went in a little ways to maintain some strength. Now, I could have bought longer bolts, but I didn't want to. So instead, what I've done is made a little pocket so that I can actually reuse the ones that came out of the truck. All right, so there's the blank panel installed. Now the next thing to do is to mark, to cut out the inside. You could put it up here and trace and whatnot. I highly recommend instead, however, tracing this and then cutting it out in some stiff cardboard or stiff paper to make a template. Because then you can actually center your template the way you like it, tape it down, and you'll get a decent mark. I just made my template out of some cardboard. You can see it makes it much easier to center it as opposed to using the actual cradle, because that was just difficult to get centered. So by using the template, I got that nice mark all the way around. And cutting this is important. You don't have a whole lot of margin of error. So you want to take your time, nice and gentle, make sure everything's clamped down. Just do it right. So when cutting out the actual faceplate opening, you don't have a lot of room for error. So it's better to have it just a touch small and have to file it larger, because there really is no getting it smaller again. You want to make sure you stay on the inside of your lines where you have a template, and where it goes and doubles and triples up here, understand that it's going to cut a lot slower. You're just going to have to take your time. You want to keep the heat down as much as you can on both the blade itself and in the plastic. That might mean slowing down the jigsaw. That might mean squirting it with a little bit of mist, whatever it takes to keep it cool. Don't rush it, because the penalty is starting over. This is what you're trying to avoid. That is plastic that's been melted to the blade. You really can't continue with that. It means I was going too fast, pushing too hard, whatever. That will have to be removed. Once it starts building up, it attracts more plastic and builds more heat, and your problems just sort of get worse and worse and worse. Here's the cradle on the face frame. You just bend over the tabs, just like if it was a factory mount, a standard way of installing it. Okay, so there it is installed. In the second part of the video, I'll show you how I wired it up, and you can see the final product.